as the world looks upon me as I struggle alone. They say I have nothing, but they are so wrong. In my heart I'm rejoicing, how I wish they could see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. I have a roof up above me. I have a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Well, you know I'm not wealthy, and these clothes, they're on you. I don't have much money, but Lord, I have you. And to me, that's all that matters, though the world may not see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. I have a roof up above me. I have a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me.
Blessed be the name of the Lord God Most High. He's the maker of heaven and he's the maker of earth. Folks, we come here today to tell you about Jesus. Amen. Folks, I've got to tell you, I think I can speak for everybody in this ministry that when we say the only thing we want to do here at What the World Needs is Jesus, is just to tell you about Jesus.
Yes.
We didn't come here to condemn anybody. We didn't come here to judge anybody. We didn't come here with any type of political platform. Lord have mercy. Folks, the only reason that we do what we do here at this ministry, all we want to do is tell you about Jesus. We want to give everybody, as many people as we can, the opportunity to know Jesus, to talk to Jesus, and to learn about Jesus. Folks, all he ever did, he didn't come here for himself. He came here for folks like you and me. He came here with such love in him that the only thing he wanted to do was make a way for us to get back to our Father, back to heaven, back to an eternal blessed assurance that we could live forever and ever and forevermore without any worry, without any pain, without any sickness, without any disease. I'm talking about without any bills. There's no grass to cut. You know, do you know one scripture in heaven? You know what? There won't even be any shadows in heaven. You know how now when the sun moves over on one side of the building, it's light. Other side, there's a shadow. When you turn a light in the room, there's a corner shadow by the dresser, the chest of drawers, or your nightstand. There's always going to be that shadow because nothing moves every day and the light's the same in the room every day when you turn it on. There won't even be any of that. You know why? The eternal light of Jesus Christ, of that love, will light up every piece in that place up there. And the only thing Jesus wants is for us to accept him, and he's going to take us home one day. I've got to tell you, folks, if you think that in such a complicated system that we live in now, in this atmosphere, and the way things live and die and grow and multiply, and bees carry pollen, and animals recreate, and so on and so forth, if you think when we die here and that's all there is, surely you're smarter than that. I know you've got to be smarter than that. Uh-huh. There is something after the death of the human body.
Yes.
Because think about this for just a minute then. If that's it and there's nothing else, then every individual would be the same. We're all made up different. We think different. We all, some people like cheese. Some people are allergic to cheese. I mean, some people can't have milk. The reason I'm telling you this is we're all so differently created and we're so intricately made.
Yep.
We couldn't have made it that far for there not to be something else. We could not have been, if you want to say, even if you don't think we were created, that we just grew out of. Surely there's got to be something else after that. If you look at the way things are today, what scientists would say, evolution. What is, then death can't be the end of evolution. If you die, surely that thing that's in you that makes you who you are, it has to keep evolving. It can't just, evolution, the teaching of evolution itself has to destinate or predestinate that it has to keep going. It has to keep evolving. The you that makes you who you are has to keep going, even after it leaves this body.
Yep.
The question is today, folks, where is that you that makes you who you are? Where is it going?
Yep.
Where are you going to wind up? Folks, I've got to tell you, there's a heaven and there is a hell.
There you are.
And like I said, we didn't come here to judge you. We didn't come here to point our finger at you. All we did was to come up here and open up this Bible, which is God's eternal word, and to tell you about a man that loves you. He's a healer. He's a deliverer. He's a set freer. He's a provider. He's the lifter up of your head when you don't feel like lifting up your head and you don't even think you have the energy to keep going. He's the one that he'll reach down and whisper in your ear and he'll say, son, daughter, I'm with you.
Yes.
Get up and keep putting one foot in front of the other.
Yes, sir.
It's going to be okay. Folks, I want to talk to you today about love. We have a God that loves us so much. Mm-hmm. You see, we can't fathom that love. Now, humans have created, or if you will, if I can use that word, humans have created various fractions of love. Well, I love my wife a certain way. I love my children a certain way. I love my animals a certain way. My car, my job, you all understand. My dress, my suit, my earrings, my wallet, whatever the thing is. We have a preference for the way we treat things. But I want to tell you something. Jehovah God, His Son Jesus, the Holy Spirit that lives inside of you when you get born again, you know what His preference is? Love. Now, you think about how we are and how we live and how we judge people. I am so thankful today that God does not judge me the way I judge other people. Because I'm just going to tell you, folks, you know we're all human. And we all make mistakes. And no one's perfect on this earth and never will be until the return of Jesus. You know, we were talking a little bit before the broadcast. And again, we're not judging people. Didn't come up here to put anybody down. The only one I come here to do is lift up Jesus.
Yes.
But you have to admit, if you see a young man walking in the mall and he's covered in tattoos and he has gauges in his ear, he may have some body piercings on his face, ragged jeans or whatever whatever it is, the dreadlocks, y'all understand he's tattooed and so on. If you don't dress like that man does, you may tend to look at that man and judge him automatically.
Yep.
You look at that man and you go, oh my goodness. I'm glad he's on that side of the walk and I'm on this side. And you want to look at him, but you want to look at him and hopefully they don't turn and catch you looking at him. Come on now, stay with me.
Yep.
And if you dress that way and that's the way you have tattoos, I'm not putting you down, sir. Ma'am, I'm not putting you down. I'm not pointing my finger at you. Just trying to make an example.
Right.
You know, we look at that person and we go, boy, that's, how could you do that? I wouldn't live like that. I wouldn't dare have my son or daughter live like that. But you see, God looks at that man all the way past the tattoos. He looks past the t-shirt. He looks past the dreadlocks. He looks past any body piercings. He looks at that man's heart. For all we know, that man may be walking down that mall praising, worshiping God. For all we know, that man may be walking in that mall going to buy a ring to ask his girl, his fiance, to marry him.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We don't know what's in that man's heart. Who are we to judge a man like that?
Right.
Who are we? I'm asking. If you see a woman walking down the street and she's dressed in the same basic manner, we'll look at her and thought, oh, that's nasty.
Mm-hmm.
Who am I to judge that woman? Who are you to judge that woman?
Right.
I can assure you, if that woman's covered in tattoos and she's whatever, how she's dressed or not dressed or whatever, God's not looking at her tattoos. God's not, if she has the little things up here or in her nose or the earrings or body piercings, that kind of stuff, God's not looking at that. He could care less than, I'm talking to some preachers in churches, God could care less about that. Let me tell you what God cares about. He cares about what's right inside here.
Yes, sir. Amen.
He cares about what's in your spiritual heart. He's looking at you. He says, I want you to look at people the way I look at people. Have no respect to persons and don't walk around judging people. He said, because that's not the kind of love that I'm trying to get out to my people. Y'all listen to this. Go with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. It's called the love chapter for a reason. You see, 13 is the number of love. There were 12 apostles and one Jesus. But in today's time, when they build buildings, in a lot of cases it has an elevator, they won't put a 13th floor. It'll go 10, 11, 12, 14. But may I say to you, you know when they put Jesus on that whipping post? The Bible says he took 39 lashes. 13, 13, 13, I believe adds up to 39. Father, Son, the Holy Spirit, 13, 13, 13. He did that out of love. Now, this is Paul talking. He's in the church of Corinth. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not charity, which let me go ahead and tell you, the word charity fully translates into the word love. So let's just read it that way, okay? Though I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have not love, I am become a sounding brass or tinkling cymbal. In other words, he's just talking to hear yourself talk. There's no depth to it. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and have all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not love, I'm nothing. Do you understand what he said here? He said, let me put it to you, if I can do this in today's terms. Let's just say me. I'll use myself for example. Let's just say I could go over here to the local hospital, county hospital, and I can start on the first floor. I can walk into every room, lay my hands on them people. They get healed, get up and walk out of that hospital, and I do it from the first floor all the way up to the top floor. Clean out the hospital. Mm-hmm. And I didn't have love, and I didn't do it out of love, and I did it so people would look at Larry and go, man, look at that guy. He's a healer. We've got to run see him. That's nothing. God counts that as zero.
Right.
Oh, good thing they got healed. Yeah, by all means. Good thing the dead was raised and so great to people got healed and they're out of pain and are back with their families and all that stuff. That's nothing. God says that's nothing. It doesn't count for a thing. You may tell you what love is. Let me just translate that word in today's vernacular. It's called motive. Mm-hmm. Why do we do what we do? Right. What's our reason behind tithing? What's our reason behind giving money or buying food and taking it to the church pantry, the local food bank, that kind of thing? Why do we give more money around Thanksgiving and Christmas than we do any other time of the year? In most cases, folks, we want to be seen. We want somebody to see us taking four boxes of green beans into the pantry. Why don't we do that in January? Why don't we do that in March? Why don't we do that in July? More money is given for charity, and it seems like greater things are done for humanity that's not in a better shape in their life around November and around December than any other time of the year. Anyway, I'm going to leave that alone. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not charity, doesn't profit me a dime. The Bible says it profits me nothing. Now you listen to this. Let me read this to you in the Amplified Version. Even if I dole out all that I have to the poor in providing food and I surrender my body to be burned or in order that I may glory, but have not love, God's love in me, I gain nothing. Folks, there's people out there today, they're giving just to show other people that they can give. You know the best kind of giving is when nobody knows it but you.
See it. Amen.
Let me tell you, you cannot hide from God. You cannot deceive God. That kind of love, and looks, that's another testimony to the love of God. People that do that kind of lifestyle, they give so people can see them, and they pray long and windy prayers so people can hear them and think, oh, that person's just so spiritual. And they sit on the front row of the church, and y'all understand what I'm saying? They're always at the eminent and prominent banquets, and because they're such a high member of society, God loves that person just as much as he loves me. That's another testimony of the love of God. You see, you can't alter the love of God. You can't make the love of God of no effect to somebody when it's God's love. You see, let me just go ahead and stop for a minute. Listen to this. Now, you listen to what I'm talking about here, because we've all been through this. One day, I may love my wife just so greatly. Oh, I'm so enamored by her. Stop and buy her roses and get her a card. And I go, honey, let me do that. You know, and I'm not dividing men and women, but my wife, she cleans house. Always has. And if she doesn't, that's fine. I can do it. It's not a gender thing. My point being is, I come home one day, oh, honey, let me cook and do the dishes. Here, hand me the laundry. You go cut the grass and I'll do the swap and just trying to do. And then Tuesday, I may go home and be all molly grub. Where's my food? You messed up my clothes. You can't do anything right. Huh? Come on now. And again, I'm not trying to divide. It's not a gender thing. I'm just using this as an example. Told you, the only thing we're going to do here is lift up Jesus.
That's right.
Man, if you stay home and you keep house and your wife works, buddy, all I can tell you is keep a good house and have her some food on the table when she gets home. I none of that matters to me. I don't care. People get, anyway. Getting off subject. That's another day. But you see my point. One day, I love my dog dearly. Next day, I come home and he's had an accident, may not love him so much. Come on now.
Yeah.
One day, my son comes home from school and he's in the seventh grade, brings home all A's. Boy, I love him. Let's go to the movies and let's go to eat pizza and I want to buy you a toy and all that kind of stuff. Next time comes out, it's got B's and C's and D's. What's the matter with you? I taught you better than that. I'm taking all this stuff away, and you're going to study till the cows come home. We're going to bring him grades up. That doesn't sound like love, does it? In fact, neither one of them sound like love. It sounds like more of reward and punishment. Boy, I tell you what, I'm so glad God doesn't do that. If he did that, then there'd only be like 75 people on earth, because he'd kill everybody else. And the rest of them would live out of a perfect life because they didn't live in fear. They'd be afraid to think, act, walk, or talk. But let me tell you something. That's not the kind of love that God has. And you're going to get mad at me, and that's okay. The worst murderous human being on death row today, God loves that man just as much as he loves Jesus Christ. He doesn't love him anymore. You see, can I tell you something about God? God doesn't go halfway. And I'm so grateful he doesn't. God's all in or he's not in at all. God loves you with every fiber of his being. He loves you that way all the time, and it never changes. He said, I'm the Lord thy God, I change not. Therefore, you sons of Jacob are not consumed. I loved you from the beginning. I'll love you till the end. And in fact, when we get to heaven, he's going to love us all the way through. There's more, and there's more, and there's more. But God's love is never failing. It's unending. It never ceases. It's always there, and it's there for our benefit. Because how many times have we been in our life, we've been so low that we think, man, nobody loves me. I don't even love myself. Nobody cares about me. I don't even care about myself. I ought to just end it. What would happen if I died? If I killed myself, wouldn't nobody know? They wouldn't even come to my funeral. Let me tell you something. God loves you.
Yes, sir.
Don't you take them bottles of pills. Don't you cut your wrist. Mm-hmm. Don't you do that. You don't do that. You begin to seek God. You begin to cry out to Jesus Christ, and you watch him come in, and he'll change the whole situation. Woo! God is able to come in, and that's what changes the situation, folks. It's that love of God.
Yeah.
You see, when all that negative stuff is around you and the devil's there poking and prodding you, wanting you to kill yourself, God comes in, changes the whole atmosphere.
Uh-huh.
Literally, the molecules in that room, the atoms in that room get changed. They get changed to a positive atmosphere, and you begin to feel there's no weight on your shoulders anymore. There's no, I have to do this anymore. What there's a feeling of is this. Whoo, boy, I feel better. I don't know what has happened in this room, but I feel better. That's the love of God coming in there. That's the love of God bringing hope, bringing joy, bringing peace, bringing restoration. Then he said, son, daughter, if you'll accept me as your Savior. That's love. It doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter what you're doing right now, what you've been doing, what you plan on doing. God still loves you.
Yes, he does.
And he's not mad at you, no matter. Don't you let anybody in this natural born world tell you that God's mad at you, because I'm going to tell you right now, they're lying. That's not the God of this Bible. Never saw any scripture in here in the New Testament part where Jesus Christ is concerned that it said, hey, God hates you and he's about to judge you just like that. Some folks think he's up there with a big old golf bag of lightning bolts going, who's next? Dare you to say something. Dare you to think it. Well, I'm going to pop you. That's not the God we're talking about here, people. Love suffers long. Here's what love does. I just got through talking about it. These next few verses, this is love. Now, this is God's love towards us. I want you to see, a lot of times when these scriptures are preached and they're taught, people begin to think about it as me towards you and you towards me. And it should be. But really what he's talking about is God's love towards us. Now, you listen to what he's saying here. Excuse me. And it says charity, but remember, charity is love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4 reads this way. Love suffers long and is kind. Love envies not. Love vaunts not itself. It doesn't boil over. Doesn't, you know. Is not puffed up. Verse 5. Does not behave itself unseemly, as in selfishly. As in, why are you paying attention to them and you should be paying more attention to me? That's not love. That's called jealousy. Seeks not her own, is not easily provoked, thinks no evil. Now, let me stop there for just a minute. I was talking about that a minute ago. Husband and wife. Two young folks, two boys or two girls, went to school together, fast friends. They grow up. One of them seems to do a little better in life, or their family maybe have a little bit more money. Well, come high school time, here comes one, pulls up in a brand new pickup truck. The boy or the girl, either one. Now, their friend, are they going to get jealous, envious, or are they going to go, man, congratulations, you look good in that thing. Let's go for a ride. Do you see my point there? It makes all the difference in the world, people. Seeks not her own, is not easily provoked, thinks no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. You know, you always heard it said, truth hurts. And it does for a time, it can. But you know what Jesus said about the truth? He said, you'll know the truth, and the truth would make you free. And if you get right down to the nitty-gritty translations of that verse, you know what it says? You shall know the truth. And the truth that you know. See, we don't know things to be true until we find out. Somebody come and tell us that there was an explosion. We don't know that to be true until we see the news or happen to see smoke. There's a fire. You understand what I'm saying? That's what the scripture is talking about. But rejoices in the truth. Love bears all things. Love believes all things. Love hopes in all things. And love endures all things. You see, if you really and truly have a best friend and you really love that best friend, when that best friend's going through a hard time, you will endure right there with him. You won't judge him. You wouldn't say, well, if you hadn't have done this, then that wouldn't have happened. A friend won't do that. And God won't do that to you. God will not tell you, if you listen to me, if you'd only done what I say, let me tell you something. We do not serve an I told you so God. He'll never stand up and say, I told you so. No, let me tell you how Jesus is. I don't know if you've ever seen me do this before. This is how Jesus does. Jesus is like this towards us constantly. And if you look closely, you can see nails in his hand, the holes anyway. He is standing just like this. But Jesus, you don't know what I've done, but I love you. But you don't know where I've been. But I love you. But you don't know how I acted towards somebody. But I love you.
Oh, yeah.
He'll always say that. Remember what I told you about but zero, what just got through being said? Pay attention to what's being said. You will come and say, Jesus, you don't know. And he'll say, but I love you. Come. He's constantly saying that, folks. He is constantly saying that. And he will constantly say that until this dispensation of grace has been removed here. Until the church is gone, he's going to say, come. We say, come, Lord Jesus. That's what the Bible says. It's in Revelation. But look. He's saying, come. Come to me. Come to me, all you that labor. Come to me, all you that are heavy laden. Come to me, all you that think you are unlovable. I'll show you justice. I'll show you mercy. I'll show you truth. You know what the best part of all that is? Remember the translation. He said, I'll show you charity, which is love. God cannot hate. There's no hate in him. It's impossible for him to hate. Will there be a judgment? Sure will. If you're born again, you'll see there's two of them. One's called the great white throne of judgment. Then one's going to be standing in front of Jesus. I'm a born again man of God. Jesus Christ lives inside of me, and I am so grateful for that. Well, one day I'll stand before Jesus. But if you're not born again, one day you're going to stand before Jehovah God. And Jesus won't be anywhere to be found because there's going to be a judgment. And Jesus cannot step in and say, Father, he's mine. Because see, when we stand before Jesus, the devil's going to be there. And Jesus is going to look at his father and he'll say, Father, he's mine. He's okay. We're good. It's going. It's, I see love all over him. It's good. Charity or love, it never fails. God's love never fails. But now listen at this. Whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall pass away. Verse 9 reads, for we know in part, and we prophesy in part. Now let me back up and read that to you in the Amplified Version, verse 8. Love never fails. It never fades out or becomes obsolete or comes to an end. Now, as for prophecy, the gift of interpreting the divine will and purpose, it will be fulfilled and pass away. See, it doesn't say it'll cease, as in it just abruptly stops. The prophecy will be fulfilled, and then there won't be any more prophecies, what he's telling us. It'll pass away. As for tongues, they will be destroyed and cease, because we won't have no more need of them. As for knowledge, it'll pass away, because when you're born again and when you enter into heaven, you'll begin being fed all the knowledge that you need that you can handle at the time. As for knowledge, it will pass away. It will lose its value and be superseded by the truth, which the truth is also can be translated into love. For our knowledge is fragmentary, incomplete, and imperfect, and our prophecy or our teaching is fragmentary, incomplete, and imperfect. Verse 10, back in the King James. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. Listen to this. I love this. Verse 11, chapter 13, 1 Corinthians. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. And I thought as a child. And that's fine because you're a child and that's what you're supposed to do. Children want toys and sandboxes and little sweet cakes. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. Folks, it's time for us to grow up and understand that God loves us. We're mature enough to know that there is a God out there that created everything and that he loves us no matter what. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Know I in part, but then shall I know. Wait a minute, let me read that again. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part. But then shall I know, even as also I am known. He's talking about the day Jesus comes back. And now abideth faith, abideth hope, abideth love. These three. But the greatest of these is charity. Now go with me to the Gospel of John, chapter 3, all familiar verse, John 3:16. We're going to read verses 16, 17, and 18. Folks, I love this. I tell you. I love talking about Jesus. You see, I've got to have this as much as you do.
Yes.
I have to know every day. I've got to affirm to myself every day that my God loves me. He's not mad at me no matter what. And then you know what I've got to say? I'm going to get out of bed. I'm going to get myself straightened up, my normal morning routine. I'm going to do my thing. I'm going to get dressed, and I'm going out that door. I'm either going looking for a job, or I'm going to my job, or I'm going to cut grass, or I'm going to do whatever the thing is that needs to be done for the day. I'm going to do it, and I'm going to do it knowing that I've got a God that loves me, and He's right there beside me, said He'd never leave me, never forsake me, no matter what. He's always here to help me. If that ain't love, I don't know what is. Folks, let me tell you, I'm telling you this, and we got another part of this coming. God loves us. We have to understand that no matter what we go through, whatever trying times happen, because they are here and they will continue up until the time we meet Jesus. Yes. God loves us. John 3:16. God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, have everlasting life. Listen to this for a minute. Said God so loved the world, didn't it? Let me bust up some theology. He didn't say, for God so loved all the Christians. Right. He didn't say, for God so loved all the Jews. He said, God loved the entire world. Yeah. That settles that right there. That part, that first part of John 3:16, you can't tell me that God don't love you because you're not born again. You can't tell me that God don't love you because you're a drug addict. You can't tell me that you had a child out of wedlock and doesn't have a husband or whatever the thing is. Or, man, you fathered a child and the child's nowhere around. It works on both sides. Told you, I don't point fingers here. God so loved the world. As far as God is concerned, when He sent Jesus down here and Jesus did what He did, He said, it's finished. I got news for you. I'm going to bust your theology up some more. Everybody's forgiven. Everybody in this world's forgiven. The thing is, we've got to accept it. The thing is, we have to say we are forgiven through Jesus Christ, and the forgiveness comes through Him.
Yes.
And we've got to accept that. Because when the day comes and you're not born again and you stand in front of that white throne judgment, God, one of the questions I believe God's going to say is, you were forgiven through my Son. Why didn't you take it? It was there for you all the time you're here on this earth. It's right there in front of you. Why did you not take the forgiveness that I gave you? Man starving to death, need money. You walk in front of him, lay a $10 bill on the floor. 3 days later, they found him dead. Why didn't you pick up the $10 bill and go buy you some food? It's not the man's fault that gave you the money. You didn't accept the money to go get you something to eat. Salvation's right there. You're forgiven. All you got to do is accept the fact that you are forgiven. Anyway. Verse 17, for God sent not His own Son into the world to condemn the world. We just talked about that. But that the world through Him, here's a key word in this whole verse, might be saved. That man might have lived had he picked up that saw buck and went and bought him a sandwich. But he wasn't, because he didn't. And if you don't accept Christ, it's not going to happen. Oh, there's all kind of ways out there to get to heaven, Larry. We don't have to go through Jesus. Let me tell you something. There's an unlimited number of ways to get to Jesus Christ. The way I got to Him may not be the way other people get to Him, may not be the way you're going to get to Him, because you're going to get born again. I believe the day's coming you're going to all call on Jesus and you're going to get born again and you're going to live up in a brand new light. There's an unlimited number of ways to get to Jesus. However, there's only one way to get to heaven. Y'all do with that whatever you want to. Like I told you, I'm not here to make you mad. If that upsets you, you just have to study it and rightly divide it and see what you come up with. The Bible plainly says there's only one way to get to heaven, and that's through Jesus Christ.
Yes, sir. Amen.
You cannot go up any other way. And also says anybody tries to come up to heaven another way is a thief and a robber.
Right.
Anyway. Verse 18. Now, the reason I got these three verses is because there you can't have one without the other. Verse 18 says, he that believes on Him is not condemned. I just spent the last 35, 30 minutes speaking on that. God's not mad at you no matter what. He didn't come down here to condemn you. He didn't come down here to throw lightning bolts at you. He didn't come down and put any type of sickness or sin or disease or any manner of filthiness on you. He didn't do that. He came down here to love you. Love does not do that. Love doesn't put bad stuff. You understand what I'm saying? He that believes on him is not condemned. However, listen. But he that believes not is condemned already. Already. In other words, there's a choice laying before you. God also told the folks, you know what he said? This day I've set before you death and life. And then, you know, it's an open book test. He said, choose life. And then he said, choose life that you may live. And the life that he wants us to live an abundant, overflowing life. But he wants us to have an abundant, overflowing life in him. He wants to give us all things to richly enjoy, but at the right time to richly enjoy them. If you think for 1 minute you get born again January the 1st, 2020, and then in 3 days you'd know as much as, say, Billy Graham did. No. Your spirit couldn't handle that. But I'm going to tell you what, if you'll stay in the Word and do what God said, you'll get up to a point where you had as much wisdom as Billy Graham, and if you tarry, you'll have more. God's no respecter of persons. Let me read this verse again, then I'm going to close. St. John 3:18. He that believes on him is not condemned, but he that believes not is condemned already. Why? Because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Mm-hmm. Folks, I tell you, it's going to take Jesus Christ. The only way for you to get to heaven, the only way for me to get to heaven, my wife, my sons, my mother, whom I dearly, dearly, dearly love, and they are born again. The only way, I don't have grandchildren yet. Larry, y'all hurry up. The only way that my grandchildren, little babies, are going to get to heaven is they're going to have to open up their mouth and they're going to have to say, Jesus, come into my life, be my Lord and Savior. I believe God raised you from the dead. That's all it took. What did I say, 5 seconds? You're born again. Folks, I'm going to tell you the same thing I told you on the last broadcast. If you don't believe that there's a God or a devil or a heaven or a hell or a Savior, give you a challenge. Jesus, if you're real, show yourself to me. If you're real, you show yourself to me, and then you tell me who you are and you're real. Make it known unto me. I'm going to tell you. I hope you're sitting down. Because more than likely what happens is a circumstance or something shows up in your life that there's no human being on earth that can fix it. There's no judge. There's no multi-billionaire. Money won't fix the problem. The legal system won't fix the problem. Mom and them can't help you. No human being on this earth can help you. Even the doctors can't help you. And then let me tell you what's going to happen. Jesus is going to come on the scene. And again, he's going to change all the molecules, and he's going to change all those atoms. And then it's up to you. What are you going to do? You've got to open up your mouth and say, Jesus, I believe that you died on the cross. I believe you was buried in a borrowed tomb. I believe God raised you from the dead. We've got to believe that in the heart. Then the love of God swoops inside of you, pushes all that satanic stuff out of you, and you'll begin to live for the Lord. Right. Folks, I love you. I'll tell you like Ron Phillips used to say, find you an altar.
Right.
Call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and born again. Folks, I love you. Wait for part two.
When old Satan comes to tempt you and tries to make you down, the Lord is there to hold you by the hand. With his loving arms around you, he'll gently lead you up. He'll strengthen you and give you grace to stand. Standing somewhere in the shadows, you'll find Jesus. He's the only one who cares and understands. standing somewhere in the shadows, he will find him. And you'll know him by the nail prints in his hands. Now when this world comes crumbling round you and everything goes wrong, and it seems that there's no use to carry on, just remember that Jesus loves you and he cares for his own. He'll be standing by when all your other friends have gone. Standing somewhere in the shadows, you'll find Jesus. He's the only one who cares and understands. Standing somewhere in the shadows, you will find him. And you'll know him by the nail prints in his hand. Yes, you'll know him by the nail prints in his hand.